startup entrepreneurs, typically from an idea stage to a stage when they're getting ready for scale. And we give them a mixture of seed financing, intense coaching, access to follow-on funding, and access to funders, mentors, and experts from the sector.
Just to add on, part of the reason why we have Pooja here is because after 8 years of building Unlimited, it's actually gone deeper into India with Unlimited Tamil Nadu and Unlimited Hyderabad. And the whole idea of actually scaling incubation actually is something that we want to hear from you, Pooja. Dave?
Sure. Hi, I'm Dave Richards, one of the co-founders and the managing partner of United Seed Fund. I'm a little oddball on the table here because we don't actually run an incubator. We invest in and hope to invest in companies that graduate from incubators. We are a seed stage investor in India, one of the more active ones. And we actually just recently launched a program. I'm not sure Paul characterized it right, my comments, but our goal, what we would like to see is we would like to see more companies graduating from incubators that are ready for investment from a fund like ours. So we've launched a program called Speed to Seed, which I'll explain a little bit later, which is intended to partner with incubators to help strengthen them such that they can deliver more of what they want to do, which is graduate great entrepreneurs that can go on and realize their potential.
Thanks, Dave. Ben?
Hi, everyone. My name is Pamela Russo. I'm with the GSBI, the Global Social Benefit Institute. We've been working with social entrepreneurs for over 13 years now in 55 countries. And we've learned a lot in the journey. We provide stage-specific incubation acceleration services that is supported with structured curriculum and then executive mentoring through the program and then beyond. And we'll talk a lot more about that and some other things about how we've scaled.
Hi, I'm Robert Karanja. I'm from Nairobi, Kenya, where I'm heading up the franchise of Wilgrow Kenya. We are focusing on the health sector, and we are an early stage incubator that's basically working with entrepreneurs, scientists, engineers that already have their technology ready, and they just don't know how to go about launching it into the market. So we give them the kind of business development and support that they need, and also enable them to learn quickly what works and what doesn't work, and help them to become investment ready.
Thank you. So what we're going to do is I'm going to raise two questions addressed to the panelists, and then come back to you guys for some questions from the floor, and then get into some specific questions again, and then hear your questions once more. So to get that started, in no particular order, could you talk a little bit about what you consider as strengths of incubation in your model, and why that's adding considerable value to the entrepreneurs that you're incubating?
Do you want to start?
Pam, do you want to start there?
Yeah, I think for us, we always say that, so we have a structured curriculum, but really where the curriculum comes alive and really makes it real is, first of all, we're focused on the entrepreneur's business, and it's with the mentor and the SE, the social entrepreneur, that are really working closely together and through the journey. Actually, I started with the GSBI as a mentor 6-7 years ago. I'm a technology executive from Silicon Valley. That's been my background, but I started mentoring. And so so really what it is with the social entrepreneur and the SE and the mentor coming together and working on their business, you know, on a weekly basis, on weekly calls, and not only looking at the curriculum and figuring out, so what's your value proposition and all the things that we do with the curriculum, the mentor really gets deeply involved in the SE's business. And I think that that's really a key aspect of the success towards the end.
Just to clarify, as I understand, is yours a longer-term incubator or an accelerator? And I'm just adding that just to trigger that conversation around the tenure of incubation.
Well, and so that's the question that I think there's a lot of confusion in the space about what is incubation and what is acceleration. We talk about we have a program that's called the Accelerator, GSBI Accelerator, which is focused on organizations that are ready to scale. But then we have our GSBI Online that's focused on earlier stage. They're in the pilot or just past the pilot phase. We don't work with entrepreneurs that are still ideating and such, and we don't have a physical space, which is sometimes an incubator kind of connotates a physical space where people gather, and we don't have that either.
Okay, so, great. Rob?
I think the role of the incubator is it's quite interesting because on the one hand, you have, for a case like Kenya, where we have a very strong R&D platform, especially in health, in the agriculture, in the life sciences, environment, and all that. But over the years, we've realized that we don't have a whole lot of return on investment in all the research that we've been doing. And I believe the main reason has been the lack of incubation activity for these sectors. And we've actually learned the role of incubators by watching the ICT space, where Kenya has been very interestingly, very innovative. In fact, if you look at how much Kenya's invested in ICT in terms of research, it's literally nothing, but there's so much innovation coming out of it. And that can really be attributed to incubators. Whereas when you look at the life sciences, where Kenya has had a track record of really strong investment for the last 5 decades or so, you don't see a whole lot coming out in terms of indigenous or homegrown solutions that are making it to the marketplace. So we are learning the lesson of how do we change this, and I believe the answer is really setting up incubators that are going to serve the sector, and also enabling us to be able to learn how to play to our strengths, because incubators are part of our regional innovation system. So you kind of play to what your strengths are, and you mitigate what your ecosystem's weaknesses are. So right. It's kind of an interesting place to be.
Right. So Pam, what you said was curriculum and mentoring mm-hmm. was what you thought was unique and your core strengths. Mm-hmm. And what I hear Karanjia speak about is the deep sectoral, expertise that you're trying to build, right?
Yes.
And then add value to incubators. Pooja?
So I think our strength lies in our focus on the entrepreneur. So our approach is very entrepreneur-centric. And I'm going to outline the 3 ways in which it provides value add to the entrepreneur. The number one is that we are willing to take a risk and bet on entrepreneurs or individuals who are highly entrepreneurial, but their ideas need a lot more work. So we're willing to take a risk on that. The second is that our every process, so whether it's scouting, whether it's selection, whether it's support, is kept or designed in a way saying, is it providing a value add to the entrepreneur at every stage? So even if you're rejecting the entrepreneur, it has to be in a way that it tells them why were they rejected and what do they need to work on to get through the next level. Mm-hmm. And the final and the thing is that at Unlimited, we place equal emphasis on the growth of the individual as an entrepreneur, as a leader, as much as the growth of their enterprise. So I think the strength of our incubation model lies in the fact that at any given point, we always come back and ask ourselves, is the entrepreneur at the heart of it? And so to compare, we're not a finance first or an impact first, we're definitely an entrepreneur first incubator.
Hmm. Okay. Interesting. Dave, you have a very, very different approach to incubation because you don't do it,
right?
But you try to make others successful, right? So talk to us a little bit about that whole act of making another effective at incubation, especially from a making them investable perspective.
Sure. So I mentioned earlier, we've launched a program recently called Speed to Seed. And the idea is, how can you help an entrepreneur get more quickly to that first investment that they are looking for to be able to move forward? And this is a program that's partly funded by USAID's PACE program. And basically, what we're trying to help do is figure out, are there ways that we can help or we can crowd in help for incubators, accelerators? There's lots of different names for the different variations of them. They're trying to help entrepreneurs such that they, through the life cycle, the result is that they're creating more investable companies. So in our case, we're a venture capital investor looking for businesses that serve the masses. But we're very much a venture capital. So we're looking for a certain kind of incubator accelerator that is producing or trying to produce entrepreneurs that have really big scale potential. So those are the kind of partners that we're looking with. And one of the things that we're doing in this regard is we're trying to do some research globally, actually, not just in India, but globally, on what are the best practices of incubators, ab accelerators, so that we can, there hasn't been much research actually done on this, of like what works or what has been working. And then to see how can we share that information, what can we learn from that information that would help incubators and accelerators. So an example is, we're sort of partway through the research, so we don't have all the results yet. We're going to publish some today, actually, a little bit of our initial insights. But part of it is the whole life cycle. How is your program attracting the right entrepreneurs and right people to your program? What value are you focused on adding? You can't do everything for everyone, so different people here are focused on different attributes, and that's fine. And then how are you connecting that to the funding that those businesses, those entrepreneurs need to make progress, to make that next step? And is there other opportunities to improve those steps and to connect those? And then, are you creating the right alignment as running your incubator and accelerator around the entrepreneur and your organization? So an example, in some cases, there's different formats of sort of structure of incubators and accelerators. Some of them are set up as nonprofits and, work off of funding from different sources. And other ones are trying to be for-profit, to try and make money at the end of the day out of working with entrepreneurs in participating. But I think the key thing that we think that it's common across, but what the formats is your reputation aligned with the entrepreneurs? In other words, is your success, can you state and can you live out that our success is going to be dependent on the success of the people that come through our program? And we think that that is one of the guiding principles that some of the more successful incubators and accelerators are doing. They're getting that alignment so that they're making sure that the right people get into their program. They're being very thoughtful about the value they add, and they're recognizing that their alumni define their define if they're successful or not. In other words, if their alumni are successful, that defines that they actually were successful. If their alumni aren't successful, then that can reflect on them. So having that alignment, we think, is a really, really key. And some organizations are a little more confused about that, but the ones that are doing well have a good alignment along that.
So let me just build on that and ask you a follow-up question. So would you consider
an enterprise that is not venture investable as a failed incubation and enterprise?
No, and so I was clear to say there, I said funding or sort of realized potential, because I think there's different goals. And particularly, one way, it's hard to use the right language, as we've said here, what's an incubator accelerator. But let me suggest that at least one way of sort of categorizing, and some people are doing all four of these things, but there's kind of four categories that we see that people are trying to experiment with. There's variations, but I'll suggest four. One is co-working spaces, basically places where people come and network and hang out and benefit from being together in some way. That's one category of sort of trying to help entrepreneurs. Second would be, some people call them incubators. We're kind of, one term we're suggesting is more, what was the term we had? Came up with one. Startup academies. And this is things that are more at the idea stage. And it's more about developing the idea, developing the entrepreneur to be ready for moving forward. And then the next item might be called accelerators. But the focus is really around ultimately figuring out how they generate revenue. And then there's a fourth stage, which we're actually seeing in the market, called a hyper accelerator. And this is ones that are swinging for the sixer in the cricket analogy. They're trying to really get big fast. And so they're really crowding in, investors and other kinds of people who could really accelerate that. And so we think that depending on the kind of thing you're trying to do, the outcome that you're seeking is different, right? And so if you're trying to be a startup academy, you're really trying to do more of education, you're trying to do formation of helping them formate their ideas, helping them become a better entrepreneur, they're likely not going to immediately start becoming a successful company out of that.
Sure.
So, and then, and they also may decide that they're going to self-fund, to go forward. They may not need venture capital. They may be more, some other kind of financing or whatever. And then other ones, though, that are really trying to go big fast and trying to drive revenue fast, in many cases, those are going to need some kind of outside funding. And there's different kinds of funding.
Great, thanks. Pam, just one quick question. You're one of the oldest, foremost.
I'm not the oldest. Let's be clear.
Apologies. GSBI, right? You know, tell us a little bit about, say, an example of an enterprise that you think has GSBI has added considerable value, and how, where they are in the whole, you know, the growth of that company at this point.
Thanks, Paul. I mean, so like I said, we've worked with over 350 social entrepreneurs, and we love them all dearly. They're all, so I hate to play favorites and such like that. But, you know, we, one of the things that we've learned over the years, when I first started mentoring with the GSBI, we only had one program. And now we actually have three. Because, you know, social entrepreneurs and social enterprises are starting to mature now. And so now we've got what we call stage-specific programs. So for earlier stage and then later stage. Some of the you know, a big name that we always talk about is Kiva. Kiva was went through the GSBI, and of course, you know, has been very, very successful. Matt Flannery's done a really good job of growing that, and we've stayed in contact. And one of the things about GSBI is that, you know, we continue to stay in touch, even though it's kind of program related. There's an end to a program, but we continue to work with the social entrepreneurs. So that's one that, you know, from a name brand perspective is one that, that's been very successful.
Excellent. Great. You know, so that brings me to a related question, and then we open it up to the audience before we get back to you guys again. How do you think about attribution, right? The unfortunate piece that I'm seeing is many incubatees move from one incubator to the other, right? Does that mean that we're not offering wholesome support, comprehensive support, long enough support, or is it differentiated services is why people are moving together? That's one part of the question. The other part is, can you really say that it's because of, you know, we as incubators or a incubator that it's created this transformative difference to that company and made it really successful? Or are you worried about it at all?
Very simple question.
I knew I shouldn't have sat down here next to Paul, because I'll be the first one to answer these questions. But so just to understand, there's two questions. One is around what do we think about the process of entrepreneurs moving from one incubator to the other? And the other, can we say that if you're
the
successful?
Attribution, yeah.
So I think if I was to look at our investees, the reason why they have moved from, and I must say that the categorization of Startup Academy and Incubator also seriously helps, because I think when we look at our investees, the reason they have moved to a Vilgro or to a Dasra is usually either because they're looking for a sector expertise, because they're past that stage when they need generic expertise, but now they sort of need a much more agriculture, technology, or whatever, that sort of a thing. Or the second is that there is a component of the support that the other incubator is providing that's missing from our support. So for instance, it may be a larger financial amount. It could also be, for instance, we don't provide any talent support, whereas Vilgro does, right? I think the third, there's a very small category of entrepreneurs who are highly self-aware, because they're not just bouncing from one place to the other because of just funding, but they very categorically choose partners for strategic reasons. So the fact that they know that they're going to be working in agriculture, so a Vilgro at a particular stage makes sense. But I think that percentage of entrepreneurs who make sort of very self-aware decisions is lesser versus people who are moving because they need financing, and that financing comes with certain amount of non-financial support. The second question is, I think, tricky in terms of do we care about, so I think there's two parts to it. No, I don't think I can ever claim that Unlimited India is solely responsible for the success of an entrepreneur, no matter at what stage do you work, because it sort of takes away from the entrepreneur's ability, because, you know, I feel like we're sort of taking credit for their own ability. But the second is also recognizing the fact that they deal with a number of stakeholders outside of the incubator. There's mentors, there's their beneficiary community, and you really can't separate the impact of that on what they achieve. But I don't think about it more as attribution. It's more in terms of understanding what is the efficiency of the services that I'm providing on this entrepreneur. So if I'm providing 5 different services, is mentoring better than coaching? Is mentoring better than trainings and workshops? Is access to experts better than access to? So I think the reason to track that would primarily be to understand, are your services adding any value at all as compared to each other?
Sure.
So that's probably the reason.
Thanks, Pooja. Pam, do you want to talk about it?
Sure. I mean, so the what we call the first part about these entrepreneurs moving around and such, we call the usual suspects. And we do kind of keep an eye out for that. That is something that we want to make sure. I mean, one of the things that, you know, our services are for free for any social entrepreneur, and we want to make sure that any social entrepreneur has a chance to participate in the programs. And so we try to keep that in mind. But the reality is that we offer different services. I mean, our focus is very much on the business models, you know, getting people to be investment ready and helping them to, whatever that means, wherever in that, what part of the stage of their enterprise is. But we do know that other organizations are not focused on that. And so it makes sense for them to be moving around and getting the benefits of the different kinds of focuses of services from others, from each of us.
And just to add on there, I mean, the idea was not to put you on the spot, but I think increasingly this word attribution, I think, is giving away to what they call collective contribution. And I heard Ashish Karamchandani and Javi Ko at FSG talk about this whole word contribution, and how do you actually look at it as a conveyor belt and look at an enterprise's success guided by many other people, and how do you see it as collective contribution as opposed to one organization making a transformative impact. But it's challenging to study it and
right.
research it,
right.
but people are starting to think about it, and
right.
which I think is great.
Yeah.
Great. Yeah. So before we get into the segment on how are each one here thinking about scaling incubation, I'd like to hear a few questions from the group out here, and then maybe we'll get the panelists to respond. If you could briefly talk about, mention your name and your question or comment. We would prefer questions. We would take a few questions and then figure out who could respond to it. Yeah. So hands up, please, and then maybe... Yeah, so maybe I'll start with the gentleman there in the blue suit. Yeah.
Thank you, Paul. My name is Jitendra Sinha. I am from Sai Sustainable Agro, and I am an incubator. My question is to the accelerators: what is the different kind of support you provide to the accelerator? How the support is different from incubator to accelerator?
So we'll take that question. Peter?
My name is Peter Frickman. I'm the founder of DripTech. From an entrepreneur perspective, getting started early on, I actually didn't have a shortage of mentorship, but maybe the biggest challenge was trying to figure out what, you know, among conflict, you know, mentors who were offering potentially conflicting advice, you know, who basically, who to listen to? So how do you guys think about matching entrepreneurs and mentors at the right stage with the right expertise? You know, because it's really easy to get advice, but the hard thing is knowing kind of what the right advice is.
Thank you. Do you want
to say? So Aaron Tate from Spark International. My question is, we talk about entrepreneurs jumping between accelerators. Could we have a situation where entrepreneurs know that if you get into this program, you'll be engaging with 3 different players? And at the first step, this player is very good. The second step, this player is going to give you support. The third step, this player will give you support. By the time you exit that program, you've got the skills that you need from the different players that can provide it. Is that a possibility? Is it happening? Should we be looking at it?
Okay, great. So I'm going to take 2 more questions, and then let me take from this side, please.
Hi, Jeremy Wade. And I'm leading what maybe Dave would describe as a startup academy style incubator in a private university in India, OP Jindal Global University. So my question is, how do you see the role of higher education and universities in strengthening the incubation ecosystem here in India?
Thank you. And one last question from the group there. Yeah, Ravi.
Pooja, speaking about attribution, mentioned that certain stakeholders often help. Stakeholders other than the incubator often play a role in the success of the enterprise. Just a curious question. Have you seen certain patterns there? Are certain types of stakeholders more helpful in the enterprise succeeding? Are there any learnings which could be translated to other firms which are at incubation?
Sure, excellent. So we'll pause with that, and then of course we'll have more time for questions from you guys. So I don't know how we want to divide this, but just because Pam, you said a unique part of your work is mentoring, can I point that question to you? This whole issue of what Peter raised, which is this conflicting advice, and how do you match mentors with the stage, and how do you manage that conflicting situation that happens?
Sure. So actually, we believe and that mentors really actually don't have the answers. And a lot of the role of a mentor is about digging and helping, having an answer emerge. And one of the things when we're screening for mentors, we're screening out a lot. Because there are a lot of people that have lots of firm opinions on things and are willing to tell you exactly how to do it. And so your job is to listen to me, and I'm just going to tell you how it's done, and that's it. And then bye and gone, right? And that's not the type of mentors that we think and that we work with. It is about becoming a trusted advisor with a social entrepreneur. And like I said, over time, that relationship is built. And that it is about being honest and being humble as a mentor, that knowing that I don't have all the answers, and it's about exploring this together and such. So I hear you, Peter. There are a lot of people with opinions out there, and they're willing to share them and tell you how to do it, but that's not the type of mentors that we work with. And like I said, we screen a lot. Silicon Valley's filled with a lot of people with lots of answers to the world's problems, and so and so those aren't the people that we're working with.
Right. Thanks. So I'm going to the incubator was actually a question because Dave actually quite eloquently captured those three stages. I'm going to request you to have that discussion offline, but maybe Pooja, if you could respond to Ravi's question on attribution, and then
sure.
We'll continue.
So I was trying to map quickly the stakeholders that we were referring to. So broadly, they sort of fall into mentors, of course, and sounding board, people who play a sounding board. There's the team itself, because they often have very passionate and committed team that they attract at the early stage. There's funders and investors. And I did put down the final and the most important stakeholder, the actual community that they work with, right, for whom the product and service is for. There's many patterns, and I'm happy to share that with you offline. But one, for example, I just wanted to give you the startups that find the first-time funders that are more aligned with their mission and with what they want to do tend to progress much faster than startups that are often spending half the time doing things for funders and investors that they didn't want to do anyways in the first place. That's just one example, but there's, of course, we haven't done a formal study, but there's definitely patterns that we're able to track amongst people.
Excellent. So this question may be for all of us, right? I think the question was, could you have one program with people offering different value, aligning and maybe marketing it to the entrepreneur in a manner that they see it as a conveyor belt, right? Wasn't that the question, right? So would any of you like to take that question?
You know, just like we spend a lot of time with our entrepreneurs asking them to focus and focus and focus, because it's really easy as entrepreneurs to get, you know, to be wanting to do lots of different things. And I think, you know, it and for, you know, because they'll just get distracted and not get anything done properly. And so, you know, I don't know. I'm of the opinion, and this is just my personal opinion, that, you know, having different focuses in for different programs, but the thing is, and we hear this from social entrepreneurs all the time, is the frustration in knowing which program to apply for and when they should be applying and all of that. And so I think that it's making that landscape a lot more transparent. And actually, before SOCAP in September last year, we did an Accelerating the Accelerators, where we brought incubators and accelerators. Paul was there, that were all attending SOCAP. And one of the outputs of that was a program that's happening is to basically help the social entrepreneurs understand the landscape and the handoffs between the different organizations, and so that we can kind of demystify it for social entrepreneurs, so that we're not, you know, everyone can still focus on what they're doing best, but then helping on the entrepreneurs really guide themselves through this sea of possibilities.
Sure. You know, the question on higher education and university, sorry about this, I don't think any of us here are really part of the university incubation system. But I'd request Rob Karanja, because you're part of the Strathmore University in Nairobi, talk a little bit about that. And maybe then I'll just add a few thoughts on how the educational system in India and incubation here. So, Rob?
I think universities do play a great role. The basic thing I look at it is, for us as an incubator, we are working within the Strathmore University, which already has two other incubators there. But the key thing that the way I look at it is this way. The academia's role is normally very good in terms of documentation. And when you're going through the learning curve that we go through in the incubation process, we learn things that are of interest also to the system level, you know, in terms of how do our government, policy, legal framework measure up to the needs of, you know, the sector or the emerging industry? And the university can play a very good role of being able to actually document that and bring out that case from an objective point of view, so that the government gets to listen to them and to understand this is actually what's going on. Being able to do simple things like case studies from some of the successful incubation exits, I mean, would be quite, there are so many synergies that you can be able to play on from being within the university system. And mostly, I think the key element for universities to be able to play a good role would be having a multidisciplinary and problem-solving approach, as opposed to, you know, the traditional, we are in economics, you know, why don't you talk to the other people in the humanities and look at, you know, things like behavioral economics. There are so many areas of convergence that make a lot of sense that you can be able to play off, and also being able to utilize them. Again, even like, for example, what we're doing in Wilgro, Kenya, we're looking at opportunities for MBA students perhaps to be able to be fellows that can be embedded within some of the incubation incubatees, and being able to provide that kind of expertise that and learning on the job as they go along. So it's kind of being able to create win-win scenarios for both the students and the incubators and you know, a total.
But it's a lot of win for the students and the faculty, but yeah. Is there real value that you think they're able to add to incubators? I'm just provoking that.
Yeah.
and then I maybe compare and contrast with India.
I found like one of the best interactions, it's kind of like, not to brag, Strathmore has this really beautiful brand, it's kind of like Ivy League, so to speak, in Kenya. And so when you're dealing with the incubators and they realize they're actually getting input from people who are in the MBA program at Strathmore, it gives them confidence. They take themselves a little bit more seriously. They're much more able to go and articulate whether it is their figures, their cash flows and projections and things like that, that they would normally not be able to do, especially since they I'm working with a group of people who are very technical and not really good on business and numbers, accounting and all that. So there's that small element of it. It gives them that confidence to go out and if I can be able to talk that I have this backing, it also opens doors for them too.
Right. So at least in India, there are the Department of Science and Technology in the government of India actually supports a lot of incubators. And other departments, the biotech department, the micro and small and medium enterprise department, the agri department, has started now creating incubators. And for the government system, it looks like it's far more credible and easier to support incubators in renowned academic universities. The long-term hope seems to be that you can really integrate a whole lot of multidisciplinary activity targeted at the entrepreneurs. However, in the short term...
Can I share just one more thought on this?
Sure.
So one of the other things that we're starting to see is a trend for, and again, early research on this, on what helps incubators, accelerators be successful, is how good, and in many cases big, is their network? How many people do they have connections to that can help in different ways with the incubate, the people going through the organization in different ways? One of the advantages that high-quality universities bring to the table is they bring the network that's actually in many ways more interesting is the alumni.
Yeah, I was going to say that.
So and being able to bring them in to support in different ways, in addition to the academics and maybe students in other ways, it's the alumni that's very interesting. So I think that's one of the, it gives another advantage to an educational institute is to draw on their successful alumni.
And two specific areas where that alumni seems to be contributing in all these 70 places is as angel investors and as mentors.
Yeah.
Because it really feel about mentoring the guys who are, you know, based in their academic universities and putting money in them. You know, two goals attained with the same. So I think these 70 odd academic institute based incubators, I'm sure can be better, can be doing much focused incubation, making more companies investable. But I think they've done a fabulous job getting started. The Department of Science and Technology has initiated it. We understand that there's a huge effort to really scale up that activity all across India. And to the extent that they're talking about one incubator in every district of India, and it looks like that will happen in most likely in universities across India, right? So that's just to respond to your question. But let me just come back. Let's come back because GSBI has been, as I said, around for 15 years, unlimited now for 8 years. Woolgrow has been around for 15 years and we're thinking about replication. And all of us are starting to think about scaling our work, replicating ourselves, the hope that we can serve more entrepreneurs in more diverse geographies. So what does scaling incubation mean for you? And what have you set as goals for scaling incubation? Pam, can you initiate this?
Yeah, so, you know, just like we work with our social entrepreneurs and how they scale and think about it, we've started down a path in 2011 forming the GSBI network. And initially that was, so GSBI is run out of Santa Clara University, and Santa Clara is a Jesuit university. And so initially the initial members were Jesuit universities. So there's 200 of those around the world, and with everyone is, you know, all about social justice. And so that felt like a really great place to start. Now we've got 22 members, and it's a mix of Jesuit universities, other Catholic universities, and then practitioner-based organizations that are on the ground. And you know, basically for us, we're all doing different things. We actually met 2 weeks ago in Mexico City. We're all doing different things, but it's about sharing. So we share all of our curriculum, all of our programs, our methodologies, everything. But all of us are also sharing among each other and learning from each other. I mean, Asade, for instance, is doing amazing work, not only in Spain, but also across Central America. And we're looking at them and learning from them. So, you know, it's a loose, I would say, kind of loose network in that, you know, there's not, we ask for metrics and things like that, but it's not thou shalt do things our way or any, no one's playing that kind of role. but it's about strengthening social entrepreneurs. Some of it is students. Some of the universities are very student focused. We aren't. All of our focus is actually out in the world. So doing different kinds of things, but really supporting each other in the work that we, that we're all trying to do, which is strengthen as many social entrepreneurs to, you know, solve the issues about poverty and climate change and you know, and doing those kinds of, that kind of work.
Pujay, GSBI is thinking about other countries, right? Scaling across other countries beyond the US. You are actually deepening in India from Mumbai to Hyderabad and Tamil Nadu. How do you think about it? How are you doing it? And what are some of the challenges in doing that?
So you can think about scale in so many different ways. The one that we picked up our focus is, how do you make incubation local and accessible so that entrepreneurs sitting anywhere in the country don't have to travel to a Delhi, Bombay, Chennai to get support? And second is, how do you make incubation context specific so that you're not sitting and being mentored by a mentor in the US while you're working in a small remote area in Jharkhand? Right? No offense to mentors sitting in the US, it's just about context specificity. And so that's the challenge that we took, sort of saying, can we find entrepreneurs in other parts of India, within India, that are as excited about this cause as we are, and are they willing to work with us to create a local Unlimited, in our case, or a local incubator in their city, state, or region? I can go into more detail later, but the idea behind that is to create this network of local and accessible incubators across the country. It sounds great on paper. There's tons of challenges around it. I can just mention a couple. One is being able to find this entrepreneur who is willing to not only provide support services to a local budding startups, but also has the ability to launch a local incubator, because that's a separate set of skills altogether. So that's one, that these are sort of rare group of people. The second is that not all states are ready for an incubator. So different states have different stages of an environment ready. So that's the other thing, that you might find an incredible entrepreneur to start a local incubator, but the ecosystem itself is not ready. So these are some of the challenges that we are facing.
You know, for Wilgrow, as we were scaling, it was about replication more, and that's what I hear in these 22 places that you guys are doing in GSBI's case, is really about replication as opposed to growing by yourself.
Right.
And the thought that we had was, yes, we need to go into new geographies, but we also said, how do you scale deeper? And maybe that's where I'll invite Karanja. You guys are focused in healthcare, and unlike others out here in the panel, what value does it add to the entrepreneur if you were, you know, focused on one sector? And on the flip side, what are the challenges of being focused on one sector?
Okay. Yes, we are focused in healthcare really because we had several reasons that made us focus on healthcare. Initially, there was a needs assessment that was done that looked at who's doing what in the various sectors. And it emerged that there was actually a real gap in the health sector. The other one is a very obvious one of my personal expertise in the health sector. And one of the things that that makes me appreciate the going into a sector perspective is, for example, what we've seen in Kenya has been a lot of innovation, a lot of incubation activity focusing on the tech sector, ICT. There's nothing more different than ICT and health. Health is just one of the most regulated industries out there. We are more regulated than even the aviation industry. So if you can imagine, what does that mean for an entrepreneur? What does it mean in terms of trying to do a cohort-based kind of system, where in ICT you expect somebody to move from idea to scale in maybe 2 years. For us, 2 years is probably not even enough to get to your prototype, you know, and trying to understand, how do you build the expertise, how do you build the capacity to do both the science and get the business right? does require really to have a much more sector-focused approach to it. Otherwise, you'd get a lot of half-baked ideas, some that are really good on the technical, but then just don't make any sense in terms of business, or vice versa. And so being able to bring that together, that kind of balanced approach, requires people who have that experience in that sector, that can actually mentor, that can actually be able to assist entrepreneurs who are coming up to maneuver far much easily. Speaking from the experience at Cambridge has been actually trying to do, been at product development for the last 10 years. And it's only now that we're actually getting to bring some things out to the market. And being part of that process has been, you know, it was literally a university of hard knocks, you know, learning at the last, at the very last minute, oh, there's a certain regulator that you didn't even know existed, and this is their list of demands, and you didn't even capture any of that in your experimental stage, and so you have to go back and repeat experiments to get the data and things like that. So I mean, it's been quite an experience to learn all of that, and so it makes a lot of sense to assist people not to make the same mistakes, in a sense, especially for this very regulated sector.
Right. And from an entrepreneur perspective, if you focused on health as a sector, do you think you can add much more disproportionate value as opposed to focusing on multiple sectors?
Personally, I absolutely believe so. I think it's kind of, you know, I talked about the kind of investment we've made in health research over the years in Kenya, and just the really very little return on investment that we can talk about. And when I look at it from, there are two things that we're trying to do. We're trying, number one, to get scientists, engineers to think differently, to understand how to read the market, especially understand that need does not actually equate to demand, and how do they actually generate demand? And those are things that, for a regulated, you know, if you talk about health, even advertising is restricted. You know, you don't just go out and say, this is my product, you know, this medicine can do 1, 2, 3. You're working with people, you don't deal directly with the end consumer, the patient. You have several layers of professionals that are the ones who are probably going to be prescribing your drugs or your vaccine and all that. So it's a very complex sector that brings out a lot more issues than you wouldn't see in other sectors. There's an element of business to business. You still have to have the consumer at the, you know, at the back of your mind in the design process. Bringing all of those things together at the right time to pull it off does require a certain element of experience that you would not get from any general incubator, I'd say.
Sure. So you would argue that it's an important aspect to have a sectoral focus. That's what you're arguing, right?
Yes.
And in health, it takes much more longer time, much more money to become successful as an incubator.
And many, many more stakeholders.
Sure.
Yeah.
Right. And of course, regulation.
And the regulation, that's very expensive too.
Right. Okay.
Yeah.
Great. Dave, you know, when you started United Seed Fund, did you ever think you would need to go back earlier stage, work with incubators in India, make the enterprises there investable, or build tools among these incubators? Was that was it part of the design, or did it happen because you started seeing deals and you started seeing maybe not so investable deals?
So, you know, our vision is that we want to invest in hundreds of startups in India over the next few years. So that that's a tall order because, you know, we focus specifically on investing in entrepreneurs that want to serve the masses. So that that is a subset of the entrepreneurs out there. I think, to be honest, when we started, we thought that we would find a higher percentage of entrepreneurs we looked at would be investable when we started. I mean, and I think another thing that's come in that's really changed the game a lot is the later stage investors are investing earlier. So in India, they would call them the venture investors or the Series A investors. They're now starting to do a lot of seed investing. So And to, whether it'll work out or not, we'll see, because it's not their bread and butter. But we'll see how that goes for them. But one of the things that that caused us to look at is, you know, when we want to find hundreds of entrepreneurs that we can invest in, we've got to get out into India and find those entrepreneurs. So we've now launched, we have presence in 10 cities across India, because we're trying to find entrepreneurs not just in the usual locations that entrepreneurs historically have been found or invested in India. And we realized we needed to work with a lot more of the ecosystem partners who are helping nurture those entrepreneurs and move them forward. So I think by nature, one of the challenges of being an early stage investor is as you get to be later stage investor, finding the entrepreneurs to invest in is technically a little bit easier. And the reason it's a little bit easier is you look at all the guys who got earlier investment and you pick amongst them as your ones that you want to invest in. So there's 10 people that got invested. You look at those 10. Do I want to invest in one or two of those? In our cases of us, when we're usually the first investor in a company, those entrepreneurs could be anywhere. And so it's challenging, and they may also not be ready yet for the investment. So these are some of the challenges. I'd like to make one more point, which is, it's interesting, one of the trends, and I don't know how this is going to play out, but you know, we talk about focusing on social entrepreneurs. I wonder, one of the interesting statistics that we saw recently is that probably the most successful, or at least it's viewed as most successful accelerator out there, they don't even call themselves accelerator anymore, is Y Combinator. And what's interesting about Y Combinator is they now have about 20 to 30% of the companies that they're graduating that most people in this room would probably call sort of impact kind of businesses now. And they're increasingly widening, you know, sort of who that they work with. And they're in the kind of the hyper accelerator model, right? They're trying to bring in, crowd in, you know, all the investors really quickly, get these things moving. So one of the things I wonder is this going to continue? You know, how much is the social and entrepreneur only incubator the way to scale? One of our criteria as we looked at partnering with incubators across India is we didn't require them to be only focused on impact entrepreneurs. We required them to have some focus on that, but we realized that a lot of times entrepreneurs that are good entrepreneurs hang out with other good entrepreneurs, whether they're focused on social impact or they're focused on other things. So I wonder going forward if that's also going to be, we're going to have to look at more organizations that are more hybrid, that are trying to support entrepreneurs. Maybe it's in healthcare, maybe it's in agriculture, maybe it's more vertical. I don't know how it's going to work out, but I wonder if that's going to be an area that is going to see a lot of, could help scale things up.
Hmm. Okay, thank you. Want to make sure that we close at 2, though we started a little bit late, and make sure that we catch up with the other sessions. But right now we will open it up to another round of questions and before we close this session. So what we'll do is, we'll take question by question because we have a little bit more time. But I'll start with Saif. And Saif, can you briefly introduce yourself? Very briefly, and then your question.
Yes. Hi, I'm Saif Kamal. I'm starting the first social incubator in Bangladesh. And as I was saying, there's a challenge. It's growing the ecosystem, as Pooja was saying, as well as the pipeline for incubation. One of the things that we see is, if an entrepreneur fails, does the innovation fail as well? Because we're looking at social impact, and not every innovator can be an entrepreneur. So what happens to that impactful innovation? Is there a way ahead for it? So if
any takers for that?
Maybe I could try. That's a good question. The first question I'd ask is the entrepreneur team, because the innovation needs to have the right team behind it. And this is something that you'd want to sort out really quick at the very early stage. In most cases, especially when you're dealing with technical people, they may not always make the best leaders, and they do need to hire somebody to lead. And having that discussion early on is really what I'd really recommend, such that they open up to understanding their own limitations and how to actually work with them.
Great. You, sir.
Yes.
Yeah. I'm Anirudh. I'm a researcher at Copenhagen Business School. And my question is, since you guys are talking about scaling, and when a social enterprise, especially a hybrid social enterprise, is in the process of scaling, there is a lot of danger of mission drift, both from the entrepreneur side and also from an investor side. Investors might get frustrated that they're not getting returns on their investment, and a social enterprise might get might just get attracted to the expanding market and might change their social mission. So how you as a power leaders in this whole game of social entrepreneurship, being an investor, how do you handle mission drift?
Yeah. Do you want to start?
No, go ahead.
So I think mission drift, first of all, doesn't happen overnight, right? So there is a there's a path to mission drift, which sort of starts from getting an investor or funder who's not aligned with what you want to do on board. So I think as an incubator, if we are working on an ongoing basis with this entrepreneur, typically we would understand the motivations of this entrepreneur as well as the mission and the intent behind this enterprise. So if we were to spot a potential mission drift before it happens, one of our key roles is to work with the entrepreneur to outline different scenarios in which it could happen. And I think more importantly, I don't think we can take a call on whether that there should be a mission drift or not. Ultimately, it's the entrepreneur's call. But what our role is to make sure that the entrepreneur understands the different scenarios and actually plot very actionable steps that they can do to mitigate that mission drift right in advance. Having said that, if there is a mission drift, despite doing all of that, and that's something, again, I mean, we've had different cases where we have continued to support the entrepreneur because we believe that we can sort of bring them back. But in some cases, we've also stopped supporting the entrepreneur because we feel that they're not caring as much about the mission drift as we think they should be, which is their call.
Can I just, for us, this is so important. And I think the challenge here is,
at the early stage, it's so difficult to figure out whether your mission can be executed in a viable manner, right? So you've funded an idea based on some assumptions, which is so early stage that has not been proven, and then you realize that it doesn't work. Now, so therefore, is it really good to call it mission drift? Because you really haven't established a strong mission, because the data points aren't there to support that, is one part of it. But having said that, we're starting to make sure that entrepreneurs take this seriously. And we've started folding two aspects into shareholding agreements and our funding agreements, which is we're saying that if you guys are going to drift, we don't worry about it, but you're not going to do that at our expense and at the funding that we're offering. So therefore, we're mandating people that they actually return the money. If it's a grant, we actually are drafting that into contracts. Now, this does not mean that we enforce it out there, because if it's a true mission drift, because which happens in many cases because it's early stage and markets at the BOP, certain innovations might not just cannot be done on a viable manner. So some drift might happen, but the point is, unless you try enough, we want entrepreneurs to try enough, and many times entrepreneurs who aren't committed enough don't try enough, and they let the drift happen. We don't want that to be at our expense, right? So I just wanted to, we started using some of that. Some entrepreneurs are unhappy, but many entrepreneurs are starting to realize that, hey, I'm in for some serious stuff, therefore I better be careful. And we also have cases where, especially when it's IP related, we have cases where people start thinking about divisibility. So the same IP can be licensed to, you know, a company which does serve very wealthy people, which is also possible. Again, we don't have a problem if those are inherently divisible. But as long as the company has a focus also on the BOP segment, we're happy with it. And in cases where they don't focus on the BOP segment, we're also folding in things like saying they would be forced to license that for that particular segment, at least, to another company which is interested in doing taking that IP to the BOP segment. So we're trying to do that a little bit, because people giving money to us are becoming demanding. They're saying, are you encouraging mission drift, or are you managing it to make sure that entrepreneurs really focus on the constituency? I'll come back to this side. Can I just go to the lady there who's raised her hand?
Hi, I'm Aprajita. I'm from snapdeal.com. So we are a company which is very interested in working with small and medium sector in the country because we are a marketplace. And we have been looking constantly for social enterprises who can benefit out of, you know, the market reach that we already have. So we are delivering in tier 2, tier 3 cities. That's where 60% of our traffic is coming from. And the technology that we already have created. So do incubators in India look for industry partnerships, or how can companies like ours, give our sort of extend support to social enterprises through incubators which are ready to go to market? Thank you.
Pooja?
No, I was just, in short, yes, because I think access to market linkages is probably one of the weakest chains that a lot of incubators are not able to provide to their incubatees, unless they're sector focused. I think in that case, you are able to provide that. So as soon as I heard your name, I was just like, have to talk to that lady offline, because you're right, in terms of especially entrepreneurs who have products and services for domestic market, we do need to proactively reach out for making partnerships with organizations like yourselves, which, and I guess the structure of it can be talked about later, but absolutely, yeah. Those are the kind of partnerships we would look for.
One of our challenges has been actually, this is not to do with Snapdeal, but in general, if you're investing in innovation, incubating innovation, there's a market making process.
Yeah.
And I think that's been the greatest challenge. I mean, the distribution partner doesn't build markets. Mm-hmm. They actually help you reach markets, right? So they address that piece. And I think the challenge with innovations, and innovations especially at the BOP, is really that. Who makes the market? And that's where the innovator-entrepreneur combine is so important. Once you demonstrate that you can, the markets are made, then bigger, larger distributors then can, of course, scale it. But I think the early stages, we're talking about the incubation stage. At the acceleration, the hyper-acceleration stage, I see some of these partnerships working. But it's so important for innovator-entrepreneur combined to make those markets, demonstrate that. And as Dave calls it, unit economics. Demonstrate those unit economics actually work before you can really accelerate it. Aucha?
Hi, I am Ravi. I am into an initiative called iSubsham, which is about setting up community learning centers. My question is, most of the incubation space is occupied by for-profit enterprises. So is there any thought of, if I'm wrong, I would like to have more information about it. But I mean, I would like to know if there is more innovative ways to support not-for-profit but financially sustainable enterprises, which are into innovative social impact models.
So both GSBI and Unlimited does that, while I think we don't do that. Do you guys do that, United Seed Fund, the not-for-profit? No, right?
Do we do
the not-for-profit enterprises?
Well, we work with incubators and accelerators that are not-for-profit, as well as for-profit.
Okay.
Yeah.
So do you want to respond to that?
Yeah, I mean, so for us, it doesn't matter if you're for-profit, non-profit, or hybrid. For us, what's important for a non-profit is that you are thinking about an earned income model, and that we're working with you on figuring out an earned income model. Now, you might always need to be able to get some grant funding and such to subsidize some parts of your business, but as long as you're thinking that there is kind of an earned income model there, then we're absolutely we support that, because I mean we think that, you know, not every problem can get solved in a for-profit way. And so being able to, you know, extend that. And what we also see, and we've had a number of organizations that we've worked with that have started out as nonprofits, but then have migrated into hybrids. And we like to see that as well. But we're agnostic in terms of the for-profit, nonprofit. You're basically your legal status.
Pooja, do you want to?
Oh, I just wanted to add that you're right that
in the number of incubators, a lot of them do focus on for profit globally as well, not just in India. Having said that, there's definitely organizations like Dasra, like Unlimited, like Atma, you know, like GSBI, who do focus on nonprofits, but locally, you're right, there is I would say there's a growing focus on for profit, for sure.
So last two questions, and we'll come back to you, one from there. Gentleman who's raised your hand, yeah?
My name is Karma. I am the CEO of SAARC Development Fund. I don't know how many of you have heard of SAARC Development Fund. That's a South Asian Development Fund. Mm. I have a session tomorrow, but today we are beginning this. We're launching the program for social enterprise development program for South Asia in all 8 countries. And one of our requirements in the SDF charter is that we need to have 3 countries. Whatever we do, we need to have 3 countries. I'd like to seek advice from you. How do you deal with cross-border investments when you have to deal with 3 countries? And I'd like to hear from all of you as to how you have dealt with it, or have you ever dealt with it? And this is something I have to deal with it, because that's the charter that requires me to do so. So I have other questions as well, but I want to hear this first. Thank you.
Well,
we haven't done with cross-border investments. I think laws in India are pretty tough to do that, especially if you're structured as a non-profit incubator. And if you're tax-exempt, the tax-exempt laws in India prevent you from working outside of India. Part of the reason, I think, why replication is happening, where others, you're encouraging others to copy your model and grow into other places, is because of this reason. I'm not too sure a centralized model is a good idea, especially if you need a lot of deep, localized, country-specific inputs. In my mind, I would think a replication approach might make far more sense. However, if you're looking at it from an investment perspective, I'm sure a Mauritius fund or a Delaware fund are all options that you should really actively consider. But in my mind, a localized incubator necessarily means replication.
No, we have no issue with the fund. We are going to fund the programs. It's just that besides legal issues that you have mentioned, do you also foresee other technical issues when you go beyond 2 countries? We have to deal with 3 countries. So this is something that we are thinking hard, and you're a specialist here, so I was wondering whether you can throw some lights on that.
I don't know whether any of the panelists might want to talk because of their own work doesn't involve that cross-border investing, right?
We're not doing any investing.
You want to talk about it?
Not from investing, but kind of offering support services. Kenya is one of those countries, very small. I mean, we're about 48 million. So when you're looking at Kenya, you have to think regional. And we have the East African community as a regional block. And so we've been thinking more or less like you're thinking, not because we're forced to, but simply the market dictates that you need to have a multiple country approach if you're going to talk of scale, of any meaningful scale. So one of the things that and it's kind of like going back to that other question on what do you do if an innovation fails. I do like that element of, because innovations are mixing two things, but let me put it this way. Innovations work or fail based on 3 things. Number one, what is possible with the technology. Number two, what's the team behind it. Number three, the context. And sometimes you may find a change in context makes all the difference. If you think back to what Nairobi is probably most famous for, the M-Pesa in terms of financial inclusion, it was actually a Vodacom innovation that could not work in Europe. But when they came to Kenya, we had the right conditions for it to work. So I'd look at it from that perspective and say, how do you not have all your eggs in the same basket? And how would you be strategic enough to do kind of multiple pilots that would basically enable you to judge whether, you know, in different contexts and have a different context in each country so that in that way you're able to get a better picture of whether that innovation is actually valid.
Sure.
Just very quickly, I think we've been approached by entrepreneurs before who are based outside of India and want our support to start in India. They may not necessarily be startups as such, but it just made me wonder at that point whether the services that we are providing to startups is also useful to a later stage company that is, in a sense, starting a new thing in a country. And they're especially looking for market research data about India. And I think I've seen a few examples where incubators have actually leveraged that as a paid fee model with non-startups, but provided them with similar market data research, which could be useful, but not from an investor.